are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon and welcome back to Theater 100, Television, Theater, and Film. My name is Naomi Buckley and I'm the instructor for this course. And today we are in our session 4 broadcast and we are going to be talking about theater spaces. So before we get going with our work for today, I of course have a couple of announcements that I want to make, some housekeeping issues. I did just mention we're going to be talking about theater spaces today. In your book, if you have the 11th edition, that's chapter 5. If you have the 14th edition, it's chapter 3. I don't know about the other editions, but just as I've said before, and I will remind you again, please just make sure to look for the title that incorporates the topic we're talking about today. So in the different editions, that might be different chapters, but in all of them, it should be called something like stages or scenery or theater spaces. So that's the chapter you want to read. And there should be only one chapter in any of the editions for this one. So this is a kind of shorter chapter that's incorporated somewhere in the first probably, you know, 5 chapters of your edition, hopefully. So please do look for that. This week, we do not have a quiz, all right? You just have the discussion board this week. So please make sure that you do that by Sunday at midnight. I do, though, want to let you know why you don't have a quiz this week. You don't have a quiz because next week, we're going to start looking at Raised in the Sun. That's the play that we do read in this class. We are going to look at the play. We're going to look at some clips from the film that was made in the 60s out of this play. And then you're going to be turning in a paper next Sunday. So not this coming Sunday, but next Sunday, which is, I believe, February 24th. You will have your first paper due. So that's why there's no quiz this week. I would, if I were you, go ahead and look in next week's assignments folder and read through what that paper needs to be about, what are all the expectations and requirements, so that you're not waiting until Monday to get started on it. And I'd start reading that play as soon as you can. You might be able to find a PDF version online, but you can or you should have already bought a copy of it or located a copy somehow, right? It's a pretty classic play, pretty easy to find. You will need to read it. We aren't going to go over every single bit of it in class. It would just be impossible. It's like a 2.5 to 15 minute hour film. So there's no way for us to watch it all. I would just have to put on the movie the entire time. And even then, we wouldn't watch all of it. So you do need to read it so that you can effectively write the paper. You're going to be focusing on one character from the play, and you're basically going to be forming some claims about how you would describe that character and then using the text to support those claims. But if you go online into the assignments folder for next week where it says Raisin in the Sun, click on that, open it up, there's a pretty good description in there. If that description is not satisfying to you, you can also go into the writing guidelines and there's another description in there. Also talks about writing plays, papers on plays. So that's another place you can go. But this is just a 2-page paper, guys, so it's not like a super big deal. But you do want to make sure that, you know, you give yourself plenty of time. You need to read the play. You maybe want to think about it and do some composing before you actually turn in the actual paper. Again, the paper is due not this coming Sunday, but the following Sunday, February 24th at midnight. And again, that's why you don't have a quiz this week, so that you can focus on getting hopefully a little ahead on that. After we do Raisin in the Sun, so now we're looking kind of 3 weeks into the future almost, then we're going to talk about acting and we'll go back to having some quizzes. Also, next week, we do have the paper, but you still will be doing a discussion board as well. So this week, no quiz, but discussion board is still due. Next week, you're going to be turning in that paper and also a discussion board. And then in about 3 weeks, we'll be doing acting. And I believe there's a quiz, pretty sure there's a quiz in that folder as well as discussion board. Okay, so that's just kind of looking ahead, hopefully getting prepared and making sure that you're staying on top of all of this. I know with online classes, there can be a lot. And I think the hardest part is just keeping up with all of the work. So hopefully that helps you. Of course, I do want to remind you that we are live and online as always. If you want to call in to make a question or comment, 310-516-4205 on the bottom of your screen there. And also you can type in a question or comment at dhtvlive@gmail.com, which brings me to our extra credit question of the day. What do you think would be the best staging format to see a play? Proscenium, arena, or thrust? And why would you use one rather than the other? Yeah? So if you have absolutely no idea what those are because you haven't done the reading yet this week, maybe open up your book and take a look or just look it up on your phone or on your computer so you get an idea of what those are. And then we'd like to hear from you what you think is the best place to stage a play and why you think it is sort of the best space to stage a play in. And today in the last part of the broadcast after the break, we're going to be talking extensively about stage spaces and how they impact our viewing. Yeah? All right, good. So I hope to hear from some of you so that you can continue getting that extra credit each week. All right, we're going to move on to our theater history highlights today. And today we're going to be talking about, this is one of my favorite theater history highlights that we talk about. We're going to be talking about Restoration Theater and 18th Century Theater. And this is a really interesting time, I think, in Western kind of development in terms of like our history and our culture, but it's also really interesting in terms of the theater, and it's a great example of how people's tastes change over time, how politics impacts theater, what happens in the theater, what kinds of theater you can see, what kinds of theater you can't see, and how that has kind of all evolved over time, right? So I think first, before we even get into like kind of the theatrical elements and how the theatrical elements evolved over time, I think it's really important for you to understand a little bit of the history of what happened during this time. So Restoration, the reason why Restoration is called Restoration, and Restoration is typically considered like late 17th century, 18th century theater, because that's the time period that it occurred in. But why it's called Restoration is because it's a period, it's not just the time period that it took place in, it's also what happened during that time. And what happened was that the English had just had a civil war, their civil war, which happened a few hundred years before our civil war, or about 100 years before our civil war. And they had a civil war, and that it wasn't so much, it was about politics, but it was really religiously based as well. We'll get into more details in a second. But basically, the Civil War, the rebels that were fighting, they were Puritans, which is a type of, a sect of Christianity, basically, that doesn't really exist anymore. But they were Puritans, and they were fighting against the monarchy and the aristocracy and that system of government, which they felt was corrupt. They had a lot of supporters throughout England. There were plenty of people that were not on their side either, but you know, there were these two warring factions within England. And it turns out that the Puritans had, you know, better strategy and more might, and they ended up winning. In the process, they executed the king, who was the king at the time, Charles I. They executed him and a bunch of other people, but they also then exiled the rest of the court and the royal family, including Charles's son, Charles II. And for the period of time that the Puritans were in power, Oliver Cromwell was the leader and became the executive of the state, right? It became no longer a monarchy. It became kind of like a dictatorship, but with Cromwell at the head. And in the time that he was in power, the king's son lived in exile, and all the aristocracy, a lot of his family members and them, they all moved to the south of France, and they lived there in exile, unable to return because they were afraid that they would be killed if they came back. So it was about 40, 50 years that they lived over there. And then when Cromwell died, his son took over. His son was not as well liked. His son didn't have as much political power and support. And this was an opening that the monarchists saw, the people who supported the monarchy that were kind of like undercover still in the government, still living in the UK. Well, it wasn't the UK then, but still living inside of England. And they had been plotting for a coup, basically, to return the monarchy to the UK. So when James, Cromwell's son, came into power, He was not as strong of a leader. He didn't have as much political support, and they did enact this coup. It was very kind of, you know, lots of espionage and, like, you know, letters being going over the channel and all this plotting and planning. And basically, after months and months and weeks of planning, they, you know, managed to smuggle Charles II back in. And in a very, very hasty and secret service, they had him crowned king in Westminster Abbey in, like, the middle of the night. And they knew that if they could do that, or they felt that if they could do that, that there wouldn't be much that James, who again didn't have as much political power and support, could do to stop him from becoming king. And that's exactly what they did. They, you know, brought him up in the dead, and they hid him in England for a while, and then they brought him into London. And in the dead of night in Westminster Abbey, they had the Pope brought in to, you know, ordain him as the new monarchy in secret, and then they announced it. And they pulled it off. And if I remember correctly, James was simply deposed, meaning he wasn't killed or anything, but he was obviously went to go live off in exile somewhere with all of his folks. And Charles II became the new King of England. And so the monarchy was restored to power in England. And that's where the word restoration comes from. It means the restoration of the monarchy to the throne in England after their civil war. And a lot of things changed between the Puritans' rule over England and then when Charles was restored. So there was a ton of things. Theater was in there, but there was a lot of things. It just so happens that because the theater that takes place, there's a real dramatic shift that happens, and we'll get back. We're going to backtrack in a second so you can see that shift that happens. The theater that falls underneath that period also falls underneath the title of Restoration. So it's kind of like other movements throughout history where we see a big cultural movement happening, like postmodernism or modernism, and theater is just one part of the pie in all of that. And lots of things are changing, the way people do art, the way people live. A lot of times politics are changing as well. And theater was just one piece of all of that. So it is just falls under this big umbrella of the restoration movement. And we call it restoration theater as a result. So let's go back again a little bit. Let's go back to the Civil War and let's kind of talk about what was happening there so that you can understand how big this shift was. And then as we begin talking about what Restoration Theater ended up being, I think it'll be more impactful for you to understand how significant the shift was. So when Charles I was ruling, he's now ruling in a long line of kings. Kings and queens have been ruling England after the fall of the Romans since something like 1066, I think, when the first Norman king was crowned as the King of England, right? So kings and queens have been ruling for a really long time by the time we get to Charles. And obviously, as with any political system, people are, you know, somewhat dissatisfied for various reasons, inequality and all kinds of things that people get dissatisfied when we're looking at, like, ruling governments. But one of the things that was happening really in a lot of places in Europe, not just in England, was that there was a big, there was a lot of conflict between two particular sects of Christianity. So after the Romans, you know, lost all of Europe and Rome fell, what happened was that there was so many reasons. We don't have time to get into them. There's a lot of reasons why Rome fell. And one of the contributing factors was this influx of a different belief system, the system of Christianity, right? Up into that, lots of religions had existed, the Jewish religion, the pan-deific, like, religions of Rome and Greece and the pagan religions of, you know, like, England and Ireland and all of these, right? So lots and lots and lots of different religions had existed. But Christianity, when it first came out, was just kind of like one of many of this potpourri of religions that existed. It continued to gain more and more followers and therefore to gain more and more political power. And in fact, towards the end, and this was eroding Rome's power, because Rome was powerful for a lot of reasons, one being that it also drew power from its religious orders, right? So as Christianity was encroaching on this, and there were lots of other reasons why Rome was falling as well, in fact, one of the very last Roman emperors converted to Christianity in the hopes of kind of maintaining and saving the Roman Empire, Constantinople, that's what was his name, was the Emperor Constantinople, and it didn't work. But as Rome was retreating and kind of all of its empire was falling and all of the lands were moving, all of that shifted over into what we now, obviously, now is Italy. And, you know, the Romans were still, they kind of retreated back into this one part of their, smaller part of their empire. And as they had lost enormous power and all these other powers were rising, there were these warring factions, one of the things that rose out of a big player that became really important through the Dark Ages and Middle Ages was the Holy Roman Empire. The reason why the Catholic Church is called the Holy Roman Empire is because it was strongly associated with the Romans and it was birthed out of Italy and out of Rome, right? So Christianity becomes a really, really powerful force. In fact, they fill the vacuum in a lot of ways. All the things that the Romans were kind of doing before in terms of just through political force, organizing and consolidating power, the Holy Roman Empire, the Catholic Church, starts doing a lot of those things as well. Really everything from even like collecting things almost like taxes. They wouldn't call them taxes. They would call them tithes, right? But they were doing these kinds of things, and they ended up gaining a lot of power. One of the other big ways that they gained power just by virtue of, again, this vacuum being left after the Romans left, was through the crowning of kings and queens, right? So at some point, when you kind of everything is in disarray throughout Europe and Eastern Europe and everything, right? And there's no like single force, and everybody's kind of fighting and struggling with each other. In England itself, there were many warring tribes. Once the Romans left, there was nobody to unite all these. There was the Britons, that was one tribe. There was the Normans, that was another tribe. There were the Scots, that was another tribe. And there were all of these different tribes. And there were also the poor and the everyday people. And then there were people that in that fall and over the, you know, the preceding years gained money and lands and power, right? And those people eventually kind of all got together in various places throughout Europe. It was kind of happening in a confluence of events and decided, you know, what would be really great is if we had one guy that would be like the ruler, like the Romans had. He'd be like an emperor, but he wouldn't be an emperor. Let's call him a king. But how will we make everybody else listen to this guy, right? How will we give him legitimacy? And one of the ways that they did that with the first Norman king that ruled England was by having the Pope come in and ordain him, right? So from that moment forward, actually all the way into now, every single coronation involves the Pope. The Pope is the one, well, now it's not the Pope, it's the head of the Church of England because of Henry VIII, but that's a different story. But ever since then, there's always been a religious person, the head of the church, who's come in and ordained the king or the queen. It's a really important part of the process for them. It legitimizes the king or the queen as being not just ordained by men, but ordained by God, right? Well, how does this play into everything that's happening here? Well, Catholics were really powerful. They were kingmakers. They could decide who was going to be king, who was going to be queen. If they didn't want someone to be king or queen, they would just say, oh, well, we don't like that person. We're not going to send the Pope over to ordain them, right? They were in charge of marriages and divorces amongst very powerful people like kings and queens. They would ordain those marriages. They were also in charge of annulling those marriages if, you know, an instance took place in which that would happen, which, you know, later on, obviously, that's Henry VIII. That's the problem that happens there. But the Catholic Church was really powerful. But in the 16th century, another sect of Christianity began to come out. It came out of Germany, right? And it was Protestantism. And it was this idea that was running really counter to everything that Catholicism stood for. And at that point, Catholicism is hugely powerful, very wealthy, not just powerful in the terms of like just ruling masses of people and having ideology, but very politically powerful. Like I said, kingmakers, they controlled all kinds of things. And you know, in order to get forgiveness, there were things that you had to do. You had to pay money to the church. You had to go on pilgrimages. There were all these hoops that people had to jump through. If you wanted to be forgiven for something, you had to go visit a priest. You had to pay that priest. You had to tithe, right? So it had become this really like bureaucratic structure that was, in some ways, very concerned with gaining wealth and gaining more power, as all power structures, you know, that get that big are. So when Protestantism came and as this kind of other branch, it basically went against everything that those power structures that the Catholic Church was trying to maintain, such as simple things like that everyday people shouldn't be able to read the Bible. So the Bible will always be printed in Latin because only priests can read Latin because they're trained to read Latin and they are ordained and holy enough to interpret the Bible. So therefore, they're the ones, the only ones that should be able to read it, and everyday people should not be able to read it. Therefore, the Bible should never be translated into other languages. And if you do that, that's heresy. And heresy is always punishable by death, right? So there were these strangleholds on things, strangling information, strangling the way that people could, you know, be forgiven and all these things. And to these people that really strongly believed in this, this is like a matter of life or death. This is like if you go to heaven or hell, right? So when Protestantism came up, it basically said all those things are wrong. Like, yes, there's a Jesus and a God and all this stuff, but like you should be able, like everyday people should be able to read the Bible, and you shouldn't have to go to church to, you know, be forgiven, and you don't have to tithe, and you don't have to confess to a priest to be forgiven, and you don't have to do penance. You just have to pray wherever you are and be true in your heart, and God will hear you, and then he will forgive you. So to us nowadays, that might seem like, well, what's so radical about that? But at the time, this was like a very heretical idea, really bucking the tide of everything that the Catholic Church had set up to maintain their power structures and their hold on this complete system. And so anybody that was found espousing these ideas was subject to, you know, like a charge of heresy, which could get you killed, could at the very least get you put in prison or punished through whipping or any other thing that they would decide to you know, bring upon you. And also keep in mind that the church and the governments are like really strongly intertwined. So church and government are kind of like the same thing. It's not like, oh, well, you're just a citizen. You can be whatever religion you want. No. The religion of the government is the religion that you have. You don't get a choice. You don't just get to be Hindu. If you're, you know, if the king is Christian Catholic, then you're Christian Catholic, right? So there had been many years of warring between these two factions of Protestantism and Catholicism, right? Back and forth. People, kings coming into power in England specifically that were more Protestant. And then they would persecute the Catholics, and then other kings or queens coming in that were more Catholic and persecuting the Protestants and putting them in jail and limiting speech and harassing people that didn't believe the same thing as you. There's stories of people who were Protestants having to hide their crosses and not be able to go out in church in public, and they were worried for their lives and not be able to express who they really were, right? So this is all bringing in a step, right, to Charles II, in that Charles II was a Protestant, but was considered not Protestant enough, right? And Catholics were being persecuted. So there was all this just very, like, a lot of, like, social and political turmoil that was happening all around this idea of religion and beliefs. And when the Puritans came out, they said, you know what, like, you're Protestant, but you're just not Protestant enough, and we need someone who really represents us and our beliefs, and the monarchy is corrupt, and, you know, we don't believe that they really are ordained by God. And that was really what started this entire revolution that rested on the shoulders of all of this religious turmoil that had been happening for many, many years throughout all of England. So when Cromwell comes and he leads this rebellion, he has a lot of people who are following him are thinking, yeah, you're being too easy on the Catholics. And these people are, you know, they're committing heresy and they're corrupting our country, and you need to be better. And, you know, this is not the way God would want you to lead this country. So they overthrow Charles and they put him, you know, They execute him, exile everybody that's related to him, and then effectively take over the country. So what we have taking over the country then is we went from this Protestant style king who had been very kind of really much more secular probably than other kings or queens before him and not really prosecuting the Catholics as much as others had. And we jump from that to Oliver Cromwell, who is practicing this very, what we would consider extreme version of Protestant Christianity. And in this version of Christianity, it's very, very morally strict. So these people, for instance, didn't celebrate Christmas or holidays that weren't really like high holy days that were clearly indicated in the Bible. They thought that Christmas was a decadent evil holiday that was intended to, you know, encourage debauchery. They didn't believe in dancing. They didn't believe in singing unless it was a hymn or a song that was to God. They definitely did not believe in drinking. They did not believe in obviously gambling. They didn't believe in women wearing anything, any kind of clothing that would be revealing. They didn't believe in the theater. Right? They believed that the theater was sinful, and that it was a vain pursuit, and that the people that participated in the theater were all sinners and seeking to glorify themselves, and the only person that should be glorified in this society would be Jesus or God, right? And so when Cromwell comes into power, we get this really, really strict authoritarian who's basing all of his ideals on this very, very rigid interpretation of Christianity. And basically Cromwell shuts down every theater that is inside of England. So every theater gets shut down and there is no more theater during the, you know, 40, 45 years that he's in power. Towards the end of his rule, as he was getting older, there was a loosening up and people were able to kind of have informal plays and things like that. They still had to kind of do it in secret. But there was some informal performances that were happening and the persecution became a little bit less. But there was a long period of time where there really just was no theater happening because it was literally a crime to go and see the theater or participate in theater in any way, right? So I know that was a really long explanation, but I think it's important for us to understand kind of like the political and sociological overtones of this period, because then it really is going to help us to understand the theater that springs out of this when Charles II comes back and is restored to the throne, right? Great. So we are ready now to move to what is Restoration Theater, how did it evolve, and what are the key elements of this time period when the theater finally comes back. So not only is Charles II restored to the throne during this time period in the late 17th and early 18th century, but theater comes back. Charles has been living in the south of France. The south of France is the France in general is much more liberal comparatively to what's happening in England at the time. At the time that all that's happening in England, France is actually, their theater scene is flourishing. They are doing all kinds of wonderful things. This is when Molière is writing. There is, you know, this flourishing. They're having this renaissance of art and theater as part of that that's happening. And this is exactly where Charles is living through most of his youth and all the way into his young adulthood, right? He's experiencing all this. He's having court masks where he is in the south of France. There was a palace down there that he lived in. And he's going to the theater. The other thing that the French are doing that obviously was antithetical to what the people in England were doing was that women were on the stage. So Charles would have grown up seeing women in plays and seeing women play women parts and plays with women in them, right? Which even before all of that stuff with Oliver Cromwell happened, there were no women in the theater in England at all. That was outlawed. That was not a possibility. So Charles grows up in this really liberal, very like artistically enriched culture for most of his life. And then when he's finally brought back into England to be restored as the King of England, he brings with him all of these sensibilities. So obviously some of the first things that he does is he loosens up all of these rules that have been happening before. You know, he legalizes alcohol again and he turns over a bunch of the laws that the Puritans had put into place, and he definitely reopens every single one of the theaters. And of course, people have been living in this very restrictive like society for many, many years now. Some of them would have just only grown up underneath this, and you can imagine suddenly kind of like opening the floodgates, and everybody is like, all these things you could never do, you would go to prison for, now you can suddenly do them, and people flood it back into the theaters, right? So, for instance, in 1675, we get this wonderful play. People are writing plays again. People are going to the theater. People are performing in plays. And The Country Wife opens in 1675. And it is just a kind of, it's indicative of everything that's going to come out of this era in general. The whole opening scene is totally preoccupied with sex. It's preoccupied with making jokes about male genitalia and what people are doing sexually, right? And it's got all this really body language. If you read it today, you might not get all of that because the language is a little different. I'd have to explain it to you. But trust me that for the audiences of the time, they would have definitely been getting all this. So, you know, we go from this really, really restrictive and staid society. And again, when all these restrictions are lifted, everybody just kind of goes wild and all of these things really, really take off. So all of the plays of this period tend to have certain elements in common. First of all, they all tend to be comedic, right? You can imagine after having lived for so many years under this very kind of serious, restrictive environment where you can't sing and you can't dance, that you probably would not be that interested in seeing tragedies and dramas. You want to laugh, you want to go to the theater and be entertained and have enjoyment. And that's what a lot of the plays do. A lot of them are very, very funny. A lot of them use a lot of sexual innuendo. There's a lot of focus on sex. There's a lot of focus on just off-color jokes and physical humor. So there's this kind of like, I think makes a lot of sense in terms of a backlash. People that had lived through this period of time where everything was focused on like spirituality and spiritual purity, the backlash to this was this kind of just bacchanalian like experience where everybody was writing about all of the kind of naughty parts of the world and hardly any focus on spirituality or morality. It was all about kind of like pleasure and enjoyment and selfishness even and the physical experiences that people have. There was also a kind of change in the way that the theaters were operated, the actual physical space of the theaters. So before, basically right before Charles II, that period right before there is kind of like the very, very, very tail end of the Renaissance and this kind of blooming of theater in England. And so that is these open spaces like at the Old Globe where we have these open theaters where we're outdoors. And towards the end of that period, theaters actually started moving indoors. In fact, some of Shakespeare's plays may have actually been performed indoors with candelabras and a lot of candle lighting. They would have started somewhere around maybe 3 or 4 in the evening so that the plays could take advantage and the theaters would have windows. The theaters could take advantage of some of daylight, but then maybe the second half of the play might even be written to take place in the evening. And then they would light all the candles and they would have these indoor theaters with candlelight. But because theaters did move indoors, there was something else that kind of changed. It wasn't just that they moved indoors, they also became more intimate. So the theaters became smaller, the seating setup became closer to the stage, and there was a feeling of fitting like less people inside, but having this more intimate experience where you could really see the actors and not have to be sat so far away from them and really hear them. And so that was kind of another change. Another thing that happened was that the theater not only just became more intimate, but that the whole way that the theater was used kind of changed. Whereas before, the theater was really just primarily a place where you would go after church a lot of times to go and be entertained for a few hours and watch a wonderful story be told to you. The theater started serving dual purposes. It was not just a place to go and hear a story. It was also a place to go to be seen and to see, right? So I like to always describe it kind of like more like a club atmosphere, right? Where it's like you dress up and you like, you know, pretty yourself up because you might see a foxy man or lady there, right? And you're kind of hoping that's kind of part of this whole deal. You're not just going to see the show. You're actually going as well to maybe flirt and end up talking to someone while the show is going on. So these became really big social spaces. And because of the new configuration of the theater, these kind of smaller spaces where people, where there was less people, so everyone's not just kind of crammed in there, there was more opportunity for movement around and to actually mingle and talk. That's a lot of what happened too. So unlike, and this would probably be really strange to the modern sensibility, unlike a play that you go see today or even a movie that you go see today where everybody files in and we sit in these chairs and the lights go down on us and we are all very, very quiet, right? It's super rude to talk or be on your phone or do anything distracting while this play is happening. That would be part and parcel of these shows, right? The whole point would be to go and chat with your friend about what's happening on the stage and if you liked the actor or didn't like the actor and to like talk with your friends and catch up. You'd also be eating. There would be people there selling you food and beer and drinks, right? And you could eat and drink while you were there and all this. So this is like big social event. And you can imagine the actors being up there kind of really trying to shout and be heard over all of this. In fact, some of the lines from these plays that are written at the time, the monologues specifically refer to that. They'll have lines where they're telling the audience to please quiet down or please, we hope that you'll listen to us for this part because it's really important that you hear this. So it was so common that it actually started being integrated into the language of the plays that were being written at the time. Another thing that would be really different would be that everything would be lit. So not just the stage, but the area where the audience is seated as well is lit. You know, that way we can all see each other and we can talk as well as see the actors. And another kind of fun fact from this time period in terms of the way the theater was really different from now is there's this kind of this trope that you may have seen before where if an actor is really bad, right, the audience boos and they throw tomatoes at them. And probably many of you have seen this or you've heard about it, but maybe you don't know where it comes from. Well, it really specifically comes from this time period where, again, people were there. It was like the play was sort of secondary to everything that was happening. Everything out here, the social scene, was really the more important part. And the actors, if they were really good, if there was something really fantastic happening, then we would be glued and we would want to watch them. But if we thought that they were being really horrible and annoying, then because we're all eating, and one of the typical things that would be passed around would be fruit and vegetables. It probably sounds weird to us now, but things with these orange wenches, that's what they were called, would carry baskets. And the reason why they were called orange wenches, because a lot of times they were carrying oranges, but they actually carried all kinds of things. So they would carry tomatoes, or they would carry cucumbers or onions or things like that people could just kind of pull out and then have this little picnic while they're sitting talking with their friends. So if you thought the actor was really horrible, you might boo them, but you might also, since you have this tomato or this orange in your hand, you might actually throw it at them to try to get them to leave the stage. And this became a really, really common practice where if audience members were seriously displeased with the performers on the stage or annoyed with them, they would pelt them with their food that they were eating while they were sitting there. And this is really where that trope comes from of a bad actor being on the stage and then being booed and hit with tomatoes until they leave the stage. So another kind of interesting historical tidbit. Also at the time, men and women dressed equally fantastically, right? We live in a time over the last couple hundred years, really, where men's dress has become kind of less decorated and less intricate than women's dress. But there's plenty of historical moments throughout history in which that's not true. And this is definitely one of those. If we go back to the Renaissance as well, there's another time period where men and women dress equally as resplendently. But men at this time wore very, very elaborate clothing. They would have many pieces of clothing. They would have usually a short set of knickers or bloomers, like a pair of short pants. They would have tights. They would have garters. They wore these really wonderful, fanciful wigs. They would wear buckled shoes. And it wasn't just all the things that they were wearing. It was also the elements of that. Did the jacket, the long jacket that they have on, was it embroidered? Did it have beading? You know, did it have beautiful crocheted lace on the sleeves, right? So men's dress at this time was, I mean, at least as fanciful as women's dress and very, very detailed. And that was all part of this process, these people going out and dressing up to the nines and dressing to be seen. So the theater becomes this really big social place. We have all these body comedic pieces going on the stage. And also one of the things that happens pretty quickly after Charles is returned, the monarchy is returned and Charles becomes king, is that he removes the ban of women on the stage. And this is a radical, radical change, obviously, for in theater in England, in that women are finally allowed to perform on the stage, to be actors, to perform the women's parts, and you know, it is a big, big shift. So we get not just women performers, but we get women entering into the theater in a large way, in all sorts of ways. And women had been involved in the theater, but primarily as dressers, as costumers, as just like helpers, helping around. Remember, you would not be allowed to be involved in any of the performing or the writing or any of that. But, you know, this ban kind of opens the door for women to participate in many more ways. And so we do get women performers, but we also get women playwrights. And these playwrights contribute in all the same ways that the men do. They write plays that are just as bawdy and sexually deviant and just as witty and funny and all of those things. And a couple of the very well-known playwrights from this time are Aphra Behn. She wrote some really well-known plays, and Susanna Centralivre. And they become kind of like the big names, two female names at least, that were writing plays that were really competing with some of what the men were doing. One of the things that bringing women onto the stage also did was to start this shift towards a greater sense of realism for the stage, right? Remember, up until this point, no women had been allowed on the stage. There was a whole group of men that would play women's parts, right? So there was a whole training system for specifically young men, usually. Once you got past like the age of your late 20s or early 30s, you would transition into playing male parts or you just retire. But specifically, they like to use young men. Obviously, there's you know, the older you get as a man, you're less and less able to kind of pull off some of those things. But they would be trained specifically to play only women's parts because no women were allowed on the stage. So these men, when this big transition happened, were obviously out of jobs and, you know, some of them not very happy about these women coming in and taking their jobs. But by allowing women onto the stage to play their own parts, to play the characters that were written as female, we get this greater sense of realism. And this is really starting to shove everything. This is kind of like the little push that is really beginning to shove everything more into a more naturalistic style of acting. Now, I think we would not, and we're going to watch a clip in a second from a play called Stage Beauty. This play was written, it's actually a recently written play. It was written in the 90s. It's a beautiful play. It is about this time period. It's specifically about a male actor who's trained to play ladies' parts and his costumer. And when the ban is lifted on women being on the stage, the costumer has always dreamed of being an actress, was never able to, now becomes an actress, and kind of the drama that takes place between this male actor who's suddenly kind of losing his job and this female actress she's now an actress who's always looked up to him but now is in this kind of rivalry with him. And so there's a lot of kind of interesting drama, but it's also very historically accurate in a lot of ways. But one of the things that it shows, and we'll see in this little clip, is that the acting from the time was anything but naturalistic, right? At this point in time, scripts would be scored to incorporate specific hand gestures and body movements for the actors to perform with the lines. So maybe one of the best ways to think about this is almost like choreography, right? That you would open up your text for the play, and it would have little symbols next to certain words that would indicate that you were supposed to do a certain motion with this word. So if you were supposed to say, oh me, right, and there was a particular symbol, that might mean, you know, hold your hand up to your forehead like this and lean your head back, right? And you don't have a choice. It's part of the script, right? You don't get to say, well, I don't think that would do that. It's like a dance that's been already choreographed for you. And this would be choreographed throughout. So there was this really, really very theatrical, very stylized way of performing that was meant to indicate certain things, right? There were certain things that were meant to indicate subjugation. There were things that were meant to indicate, you know, fear or, we would consider them very kind of cheesy and non-naturalistic and over the top. But this is what people had come to expect from the theater. This is what was considered good acting, right? So the acting from the time was really anything but naturalistic, but it was moving in a more naturalistic way, and it was really this kind of moment where women were allowed onto stage that gives it an extra push, so that as we head into the end of the 18th century and the beginning of the 19th century, we really see realism taking off and this whole shift towards more realistic and naturalistic acting. But at this time, really, there is still a lot of this very large, declamatory style of acting that has all these scored movements that go with it that to us are going to seem kind of ridiculous and over the top. But let's watch this little clip, because I think it's going to make what I'm saying to you kind of like much more clear in terms of the style of acting that existed at this time. So let's watch this clip from the film version of Stage Beauty.
But where is that Promethean heat that can thy life resume?
She wakes.
Who's there? Othello?
Aye, Desdemona.
Will you come to bed, my lord?
Have you prayed tonight, Desdemona?
Aye, my lord.
If you bethink yourself of any crime unreconciled as yet to heaven and grace, solicit for it straight.
Alas, my lord, what do you mean by that?
Well, do it, and be brief, I will walk by. I would not kill thy unprepared spirit. No, heavens forfend, I would not kill thy soul.
Talk you of killing?
I do.
What's the matter?
That handkerchief that I so loved and gave thee, thou gavest to Cassio.
No! By my life and soul, send for the man and ask him.
Down!
Trumpet! Kill me tomorrow, let me live tonight.
Nay, if you strive.
But half an hour.
Being done, there is no cause.
But while I say one prayer.
It is too late.
Wonderful. I love that clip. So that's the opening scene of Stage Beauty. And what we saw there, if you recognized it, was a performance of the final scene, one of the final scenes in Shakespeare's Othello, where Desdemona is killed by her husband because he believes that she's been cheating on him. And we see Billy Crudup, who is the guy who plays Desdemona, is playing the main character, who is a man who has been trained to play women's parts. And then we see the other character who's playing Othello, the Moor. And of course, all kinds of crazy things happening there that seem very not naturalistic, right? First, the guy that's playing Othello isn't actually a black guy, right? He's wearing basically blackface, which would have been completely acceptable at the time. Now, of course, very offensive, but at the time, no problem, right? And we also see Billy Crudup, who is clearly a man, playing a woman's part. And then as we're coming to the end of that scene, Amelia comes on, who is Desdemona's handmaid, also played by a man, right? And this just would have been the way that everybody saw Othello, the play, for a long time. Many, maybe at this point, even 100 years had, like, since that play had been written. And every time you went to see it, it would have been a man playing the part of Desdemona and the men all playing all the parts, right? When Shakespeare performed, it would have been done with men. So to now, you know, for us to see that, we're like, well, this is so bizarre and, like, obviously not anything near a naturalism. And all of these, you know, hand movements and gestures, but this would have been the accepted style of theater at the time, completely, you know, and that would have been considered a wonderful performance of that scene, right? The other thing I love about that play, and if you see the film version, is how you get to see what these theaters look like. So you can see that that space, you know, maybe a larger size space in terms of some of the more intimate spaces we have today. It probably fits somewhere about around 300 or 400 people, so it's not itty bitty. But you see people mostly in boxes. I think there's a shot where you swing around and you see the people seated in kind of what we would call like the orchestra area now, right? So this sort of a smaller style, more intimate, you know, theater was becoming more popular. It might seem like, wow, there's still a lot of people in there, but compared to what had come before, when we think about Shakespeare's time, when we would get 1,000 people at least into these theaters, to only have 300 or 400 felt like a much smaller space and a much smaller audience. It allowed you to have a little bit more of this intimate experience. And hopefully you also notice, you know, the candles on the sides, and there would have been candles everywhere in that space to illuminate what was happening. All right, so another style that kind of came out of this time was called bourgeois drama. And bourgeois drama was something that happened towards the end of this period. It's another kind of pendulum swing back towards the end. People are kind of now starting to feel this backlash against all of this kind of debauchery and all this focus on pleasure and the body. And bourgeois drama comes in and kind of goes in the complete different direction, and we get a focus on not upper class people like doing all kinds of crazy things and cheating on each other and spending money and eating and drinking and having fun all the time, but we get a focus on middle class people who are concerned with moral things, right? And so these plays tend to focus on middle class families that are not part of the aristocracy, kind of living these lives, and always present it with some kind of a moral dilemma that they succeed at. They make the right moral choice in the end, even maybe at their own expense. So for instance, a play like The Careless Husband, which is a play which is from this time period, at the end of this time period, it reveals, you know, this woman makes a big sacrifice, and in the end it reveals the true depth of her love for her husband, and that she is a, you know, a good and moral wife, unlike some of these other wives that you would have seen featured earlier on in the period that were, you know, kind of always cheating on their husbands and sleeping around and trying to cheat them, like financially and all these things. Also, the plays tend to be kind of very, very overly sentimental and concerned with kind of this kind of saccharinely sweet presentation of morality and life. But you can see, again, this is as a direct kind of backlash to some of the kind of crazier things that were represented in the earlier period. In this time as well, now we're moving away from the more intimate theaters. We're growing the theaters again. We're becoming bigger, and more people are getting fit back into these theaters. We're having these kind of larger experiences again. Another thing that happens in actually in the 19th century, in 1809, so now we're kind of moving way to the end of this period, is the Covent Garden riots, right? And this was a time period in which, as the theaters grew larger and more people were able to come and see the theater, we have a burgeoning middle class that's able to go and see the theater now more frequently. We want to fit more people in. These really large theaters sprung up. And the theater would have typically like a ground seating area, and then like you can see in this picture here, all along the walls on the sides would be what we call like boxes in the galleries. So you can kind of see, here I'm actually gonna use this. You can kind of see like right here, these are all the boxes, right? And these are the areas where if you had a lot of money, I mean, they're practically on the, they're on the stage, right? You would be able to sit. This down here, this is where like the average person would sit. And what you can't see in this picture is what would be facing opposite these actors here. These aren't actually actors, I don't think. But would be the boxes at the back of the house. And those are actually cheap seats as well because you're really far away from the stage. So the reason why you need to understand that, and we can come back to me now, thank you, is that the different seating areas had different prices, just like they do now, right? So you had the cheap seats, you had the really expensive boxes, and you had other more cheap seating in the back. When Covent Garden closed down for a short period of time, well, depends on what you consider short, to renovate. They were closed down. This was like really upsetting to a lot of people because remember, this is one of the few entertainment forms you have. They closed down, and in their time of being closed down, they make this announcement that they're doing all these renovations to the theater. When they reopen, they're going to be charging more for their tickets. But the more that they're going to be charging is not for any of the boxes. So not for any of those really expensive seats. It's all the cheaper seats that the prices are going to be raised on. Well, this was really upsetting to people that, you know, they were like, this is our only form of entertainment. And, you know, you're raising the prices on us. We're not really getting hardly any of the renovation in those spaces. It's all being done to the boxes and all these other things. And yet we're bearing the primary brunt of the financial burden. And this is basically what happened in the Covent Garden riots. So when they reopened, they enacted this price hike and didn't listen to their patrons. And people got so angry that they literally rioted out in the streets for like, what was this, 67 nights of rioting. And people died, right? They were so angry about these ticket prices going up and the theater not listening to them and refusing to raise prices on the boxes and raising all the prices only on the cheaper seats. And it really was kind of one of those instances, right, of taxing the poor in order to benefit the rich. And they did not stand for it. And what the kind of interesting outcome of all this is that at the end, they rioted, but they also boycotted the theater. So they weren't, nobody was going in, at least for the cheaper seats, to go and see the theater. And they forced the hand of the theater, and they finally, in the end, gave in, and they divided the cost of the increase amongst the boxes as well as the cheaper seats and made everybody happy. And this kind of marks this moment in time in which the audience is really having, because the middle class is so big, so therefore the audience, the majority of the audience that's coming in to see these plays is of the middle class. They end up having a lot of purchasing power and a lot of influence over what the ticket prices are and what kinds of things are going to be shown. And which actors are going to come up and see certain things. And it really is kind of this demarcation between only aristocrats and powerful people and moneyed people having power over what happens in the theater. And that shift to the middle class and people, working class people, having control over that. As I said, the theaters continue to expand so that we get a theater that at some point, like the Drury Lane Theater, holds over 2,000 people. Enormous. You can see this wonderful picture here. And just thousands of people all together in this space, right? Entire walls full of people, and each of those boxes have more than one level of people sitting inside of them. And then the bottom is also really, really big. And the types of shows that are being shown on the stage as well change. They become melodrama sort of evolves out of this time period. We get really, really big, epic stories, animals brought onto stage, flood the stage. There's a story of like a pirate ship being built on one of the stages, so they could do this pirate show. There's just all kinds of amazing things that start happening that lead us right into the 19th century theater and even into the 20th century, where this is really a big booming industry, and right up into when film starts competing with the theater. And melodrama is really where we get a lot of our genres in terms of what you see on TV and in film, like horror and Western and adventure and all those things. Those genres really didn't exist until the end of the 19th century, beginning of the 20th century, when these kind of, we had this influx of this enormous amounts of audience coming in, and this desire to kind of really do these really big shows that were very epic and full of spectacle that would entertain these mass audiences and keep them coming back, right? Well, guys, that brings us to the end of our epic discussion about Restoration Theater. Later on in the semester, in week 13 and 14, we're going to be going over costumes as well as lights and sound. For right now, this will be the only part of design, theater design, that we're going to talk about, because the next few weeks is going to be talking about some of the elements that don't have to do with lights or sound or costume or scenery. But this brings us definitely to the end of this section. And when we come back from the break in about 5 minutes, we're going to dig right into one of the first elements of design, which is theater stages and theater spaces. And when we come back as well, I do see that some people have written in for the extra credit, and we'll read those as well. So how about I see you back here in 5 minutes, and then we'll end our broadcast with talking about theater stages.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting, because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man's able to be clean, they feel good. It gives this confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it, the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zenea Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you. Well, hello and welcome back. We're back after our break. My name is Naomi Buckley. I'm the instructor of this course. This is Theater 100. And in this last part of our session today, we are going to be talking about theater spaces and how they impact our viewing of a show that we might see in that space. Before I start with that, I want to take us back to our extra credit question for the day in case anyone else would like to type in the last part of the session today. Our question is, what do you think would be the best staging format to see a play in? Proscenium, arena, or thrust? And why would you use one over the other? So we do have a few people that have typed in today. I'd love to read their responses before we move on. Jennifer has typed in and she says, the best format to see a play in would be a proscenium. I would rather see a play in that setting because it creates a different atmosphere for the audience. For example, it looks like it sets the mood and tone perfectly for any kind of play. Good. So nice comment there, Jennifer. And Brittany says, what I think would be the best staging format to see a play in is proscenium because it creates a window around the scenery and performers. With this staging format, there is a way for everyone in the audience to have a good view because the performers need to only focus on one direction rather than moving around the stage to give a good view from all sides like they would have to do with an arena or a thrust stage. The action of the play is framed with proscenium staging, which is why I think it's the best staging format to see a play. Good. Very nice, Brittany. Very thorough answer. And you're right. Proscenium style stages are actually one of the most common style stages today throughout the United States. Most places where you go to see a play are some style of a proscenium stage. Probably the next most common is a thrust sort of space. And we're going to talk about all of those and their benefits and their drawbacks, and there are a few other ones as well. But before we get going with that, let's just take a little bit of time to think about how the space itself is kind of a thing that is taken for granted as we look at it from the audience member's perspective, right? But it really, really impacts the way we're able to enjoy a show. It may impact the way we receive a show. Whether we enjoy it or not, it definitely has an impact on the way that we perceive and receive a show. So even though it's one of the things you really don't think about, you kind of just like walk in and you're like, oh, this is where I'm supposed to sit. And you sit and then you're like, you know, stuff is going to happen. And I'm going to watch it. But what you don't realize is that where the audience is set really impacts the way the audience will receive and participate in the viewing experience. So as I said, most of the spaces that we walk into are proscenium style stages. These are stages that have a what we call a picture frame around the playing space. Proscenium is from an Latin word, but it's an Italian style of stage. We got it from the Italians. Here's a nice side view of it, where we see the picture frame at the front of the stage, right? And then there are these, in this one we have panels or legs that go back that have other scenery on it. That's an older style of staging in proscenium staging. But today, where those panels would be, we would have these curtains
these long curtains that hang that we call legs, and they help to conceal entrances and exits onto and off of the stage. And then the scenery is three-dimensional now. When we first got proscenium staging, the scenery that we would put on the stage was not three-dimensional. It was all two-dimensional, painted flats and painted legs like this. Now, as we moved into the era of realism, we have these three-dimensional sets that sit on the stage, and those are the pieces that sit within that picture frame. So it's a picture frame theater with a proscenium arch. That's the frame that goes around, through which the audience watches the actors. And the purpose is illusory and requires designed scenery. The purpose is to frame the action in such a way that we know exactly where to look and that we feel as though we're looking at kind of a piece of art or a scene happening out in front of us, separate from us somehow, right? That's being framed by this actual proscenium. It is kind of good to note that, like, proscenium staging, again, it comes to us from the Italians, and it existed all the way. I mean, we have examples of proscenium stages going all the way back, I think, to the 14th century even. And the way that we have used proscenium staging over time has really changed. So, like, again, going back to the picture behind me, this has painted flat scenery. Now we use it with, yeah, so here we can see the painted flat scenery. Let me see here if I can get rid of that. So here we see this is the proscenium arch, right? Right here. And then we have this painted, these legs that are painted, but they're two-dimensional. They're just intended to give the illusion of depth, but they don't really have depth. Now behind this, we would have three-dimensional sets. But the other thing I want to point out in this, let's see, get that to go away, is this area right here. What you'll notice, this is called the apron of the stage. And this is very, very small, right? So this is a part of the stage where this, obviously, in this is not intended to be acted on. We are not going to have actors on this. Actors are all going to be behind the proscenium and acting through this hole right here. But there are other periods of time, specifically in the 16th and 17th century, where we use this, where this apron would be very large. And most of the acting would take place on the apron in front of the proscenium. Nowadays, the apron is definitely bigger than this, but still not as large as we would have seen in the 16th and 17th century. We can do some acting on the apron, but we still do try to keep a lot of it behind the proscenium arch there. Here we see the orchestra, right? This is where if there's any musicians, they're in this orchestra pit right here. And then this is where the audience sits. And one of the things you should notice about this is that the audience seating is raked. That means we come from a higher place to a lower place, right? That might seem obvious to you. Most of our audiences nowadays are raked, but in the past, it would be the stage that was raked. So the stage would be at an angle, the audience would be flat, and because the stage is at an angle, it allows actors to be seen no matter where they are on the stage. But that changed basically right into the 17th century, where we started getting flat stages and raked seating areas. So what are some of the other important parts of the proscenium? The fourth wall, which is the area that the picture frame frames the fourth wall, right? This here is an invisible wall that the audience and the actors sort of agree is there. and that is a way that we can see action that's taking place, but we get to watch it as kind of unseen voyeurs, right? We're watching it, but we're not seen. So the actors pretend that the audience isn't there, and the audience pretends that the actors don't know that they're there, right? Of course, that's a really relatively new invention. As you know, if you remember what I just said before the break, in previous times, even though we had a proscenium, the actors still would acknowledge the audience, and the audience would acknowledge the actors. What are some of the other parts? Well, we have the house, which I pointed out to you. That's where the audience sits. The rake of the house, which is the angle that they're sat at so that they can all have good eye line onto the stage. The orchestra, which is where all the people were sitting, I drew on there where they're sitting, the musicians. The boxes, which we showed in another picture, that's all those boxes that line the walls in a proscenium. Not every proscenium stage has that, but some do. And the fly loft, the counterweight system, and the wings. So all that is stuff that appears above the stage or on the sides of the stage that the audience actually can't see. But those are all part of that whole system. So what are the wings? We kind of pointed them out before, but they're a left and right offstage area. They're narrow standing areas where pieces of scenery or curtains, also called legs, as I said, that stand parallel to the proscenium and form scenery and or masking for the sides of the arch so that any machinery can be hidden behind there as well as any actors that are about to enter can be hidden behind there. Can we go to a full screen of this and I'll show specifically what the wings are here. So here we can see this bit right here is part of a wing system or some kind of a leg system. Obviously, if there was an actor standing behind here, you would not be able to see them, or if there was some kind of, you know, machinery or some other piece that was going to come out on the stage, it would hide it. This is a top part of the curtain, but you can see a little bit of the wings on that side too. But the wings incorporate not just this platforming, but everything you can't see as well. So that space extends into the side there, even where you can't see, and that's also part of the wings, right? So this allows actors to come in and out without being seen. It allows set pieces to be moved in and out without being seen. And, you know, also can conceal other things that might be hiding back there that, you know, you don't ever see. But we use as part of, you know, it could be chairs we're sitting down or where props are hidden or things like that. So the wings are really important to being able to create this kind of illusion on the stage and for the audience. So this example that we're looking at here actually is the Teatro Farnese, and this is probably the first proscenium arch in the world. And again, I told you it came from Italy, and part of the reason why it came from Italy is because during the Renaissance, the idea of perspective painting and the technique for perspective painting all evolved out of Italy, and it was those ideas that evolved into this idea of a proscenium stage. So this kind of picture frame, like you would have in a piece of art, and then this perspective, these drops that would be painted in this elaborate perspective to create depth to the stage. And this is an actual painting here of a backdrop, which you can see, like in reality, this is not going on and on forever, but it's giving the illusion of this enormous amount of depth and all of these like columns that just go on for, you know, a mile at least, a football field at least, and yet all of that's just created through the illusion of perspective painting. So they would do that through backdrops as well as those kind of painted flats that they would also pull in at the sides, and then they would get the perspective would get smaller and smaller so that it looked like there was a vanishing point, right? Giacomo Torelli created sets for the proscenium theater. He was a really well-known set designer, but not just a set designer. He was also really involved with evolving and creating new types of machinery for the stage. He worked out of Italy, but he ended up kind of traveling all over the world. He was one of the experts in the field and painting backdrops for kings and queens all over the world. And in their theaters, he went to France, he went to the UK. I mean, he really went all over the place. He was very famous. And he really helped to evolve this style of perspective theater, as well as creating what we call the pull and chariot system, which was a way to move these perspective painted flats in and out of the wings very, very quickly so that we could have quick scene changes between the plays. So later on, as we're moving forward in time, one of the things that evolves, as I said, is this idea of a fourth wall that we place into the proscenium stage, but it also gets placed into really all of the other stages as well. And this is, again, the idea that there's an imaginary wall that separates the actors and the audience that allows us to watch what the actors are doing without them acknowledging our existence. And in this way, the actors are able to act naturalistically as if we're just peering in on these people's lives, but we are these unseen viewers. You can see how that obviously dovetails into film and cinema and television, all the things that evolve after that, but it really started in the theater, this idea of the audience simply being like peeping Toms, right? And we all peer in through this window and we get to see these people living their lives, but they don't acknowledge us. And because of that, they can act in these really, really naturalistic ways. Let's move on. The fourth wall is a term there. You got that one. And let's move on. We've got a few more styles of theater spaces to cover. So we just talked about proscenium. Let's move on. Another style is called arena theater, also known as theater in the round. And this is an adaptation of the original Greek and Roman spaces, right? In the Greek and Roman spaces, we had the skene in the back and the paraskene. You can kind of see the picture there. That's where the actors performed on this kind of stage. But we also had this circular shape, right? This circular shape at the bottom that we called the orchestra, where the chorus would perform and sometimes the actors would cross down in. And we have the audience kind of surrounding all of these in this circular way. So arena can mean where audience sits on almost all sides of the circle, except for this area in the center, but it can also mean seating all around the playing space. So sometimes we have theaters in which the playing space is in the center and audience is seated all the way around the playing space. And sometimes it's more like the original Greek and Roman versions where we have a little area of the circle that's kind of clipped out just for playing, but then we still have audience around almost three quarters of the playing space. So to be more exacting with that definition, it is a theater with a playing space in the center, and that playing space is either in the shape of a square or a circle, it doesn't really matter, but it's got seats that allow for spectators to be all around it or at least three quarters of the way around it. The stage itself is usually raised to allow for better sight lines for the audience. And some of the advantages of this is that it's very immersive, right? It allows the audience to feel like they're kind of like in this, it's very intimate and immersive, and it allows the audience to kind of see this thing happening in a much more kind of realistic way. But some of the drawbacks is that you can have sight line issues, and it's very, very challenging to direct plays in this kind of a space because the actors have to play to all the sides of the audience. And that means really moving actors constantly so that we don't get an actor with their back to one part of the audience for a really long period of time. So you can see how there might be some plays where this style of staging doesn't really work well. Or if we have a play where maybe a lot of tricks need to happen or kind of like effects, in order to conceal that from the audience, to try to do that in an arena stage or in the round seating, that can be almost impossible. So some plays are much more conducive to that style of staging and some are not. But definitely if you need a lot of scenery, right, that would create a sightline issue. Or if you need a lot of special effects or something, or you have a lot of a show with a huge amount of spectacle, then this kind of seating is really not conducive to it. But if you have a play that's more naturalistic, that doesn't have a lot of those things, and where you can move actors around a lot and that makes sense to the pacing and feeling of the play, then those types of seating arrangements can be really, really engaging. So obviously the Theater of Dionysus and the Greeks are the ones who originated this with the three-quarter circle with audience seated mostly around the side. But also medieval drama adapted this style of staging when they would take their pageant plays and their morality plays all across the European countryside. They would often pull their wagons up and put them in a semicircle, and then they would have audience seated in three quarters around, right? So we have a circle with more of that Greek or Roman feeling where we have audience on three quarters sides of that circle and the playing is happening here. You kind of see that in that picture there. And here we also see that the stage is elevated. That's really important so that everybody that's looking can see what's happening. All right, our last stage is the thrust stage. And this is really a combination of the proscenium and the arena style staging, right? So this is something where we get a piece of the stage, we get part of it is like our proscenium, and then part of it thrusts out into the audience. And this is actually very much like a Greek stage. This is kind of what the Greeks had, right? They had this kind of proscenium style piece in the back. And then they had this piece that thrust it out into the, and so here we see this thrusting out here into the space. And we get audience on three quarters all the way around, sitting around, right? What you can't see behind here is that there is a proscenium style bit of the stage that sets behind that area. So what is the really clear definition of this? Well, it's a combination of proscenium and arena where audience sits on three sides. It encloses a stage which protrudes at the center, and it allows for there to be a better view of the actors, and so that you get that intimacy, but you can also play back on the proscenium part, so you don't, you can also include effects, and you can also have maybe more set and scenery and all of that. So it's got kind of both of those elements that play into that. And that picture that we were just looking at is a picture of the Guthrie in Minneapolis. It's a really well-known thrust stage. It's a great space to do things like Shakespeare in or Greek plays in, but there's also a lot of different types of modern pieces that fit into those spaces as well. The Swan Theater from the Elizabethan age, and this is now going back to Shakespeare's time, is really a really famous example of a thrust stage. Here we can see, so this is the Swan. This is Shakespeare's, we believe that he performed some of his plays in this space towards the end of his career. Here's the part that thrusts out into the audience, and here's the part that's more proscenium-like. And we get audience sitting around on three quarters, and you would also have audience here that would be able to abut right next to the thrusted part of the stage. So also the Spanish corrales were also very similar in style to what we just saw. Those were like thrust stages as well, where we would have audience seated kind of around like that with a thrust-like stage. It didn't have exactly a proscenium in the back, but it's very, very similar in its style. So those are the main styles of stages that we have available to us, and we'll just quickly, I want to go over them with you again. Proscenium, which is the picture frame, right? Arena, which is theater in the round all the way around, right? And then a thrust stage, which is basically a thrusted bit mixed, like it's kind of like in the round mixed with proscenium, and we get audience on three quarters sides of that circle. But as we've moved into more modern ways of performing and mixing realism and theatricality, as well as other styles, surrealism and absurdism, there's also other different kinds of spaces that people perform in. Some of these are found spaces. There's something called site-specific theater, where you go and you perform in a park because maybe the play takes place in an outdoor area. You perform in a barracks because this play takes place in a barracks, and we find places to seat the audience. We can also use, as I said, in those instances, non-theater spaces. We can convert them into theater spaces. We can adapt spaces to serve our needs. There are things called street theater, where people like just start performing scenes on the streets, like people watch to stop to watch. And then we also have spaces called black box spaces. We have one of those here on campus, and these are multi-function spaces, which are intended to be able to transition into any style of playing space. So we can create a thrust stage in a black box. We can create theater in the round. We can create proscenium style theater in a black box. It's meant to be a multi-purpose space in which we can do almost anything inside of this space. So, goodness, that was a lot today, wasn't it, guys? One second. So, the type of space that you see a show in really impacts the way that you receive what it is that is being performed in front of you. If you're in the middle of that action, you perceive it in a different way than if you're seated far away from the action and there's this picture frame around it, right? If you are, very close to the actors, that's a different experience than being very far away from them. If you're watching actors move around all the time and there's very little scenery, that impacts how you perceive and receive what's being performed in front of you. So the space is an integral part of how a play is received, and kind of even the whole feeling and vision of the piece is expressed through where the audience is seated and how the configuration of the stage has been created for you to receive that piece. So hopefully you understand now that stages are really important. There's lots of different ways to seat an audience in relationship to the players. And like I said, in a few weeks, well, in several weeks towards the end of the semester, we'll also be covering some other design elements like costume, lights, and sound. But I do want to remind you that next week, you have your Raisin in the Sun paper due. Please start reading that. This week, all you have is your discussion board. Make sure you get that done by midnight. There's no quiz this week. Next week, the paper and the discussion board. And then the week after that, we'll be moving on February 28th to acting. And then that'll be more of our standard format of lecture, discussion board, and quiz, right? But we covered a lot today. We talked about Restoration Theater, the history of all of that, the evolution of that through politics and how it impacted the theater, as well as different types of stage spaces, how they have evolved over time, and the benefits and drawbacks to some of those as well, and looking ahead to what's coming up. So again, please make sure to look ahead, do your discussion board this weekend by Sunday, and look ahead to Raisin in the Sun as well. And next week, we'll be talking about Raisin in the Sun and watching some clips. And I look forward to seeing you again next week. Thanks so much for tuning in.